Welcome to Manna-Fest, hosted by international evangelist, teacher, and author Perry Stone. Enjoy unique insight into prophetic and practical truth. It's time to feast on fresh manna, so get ready to be blessed and encouraged. And now, here is your host and teacher, Perry Stone.
I'm going to preach on the Chronicles of Counting Prophetic Time, the Chronicles of Counting Prophetic Time, Daniel chapter 12, verse 4. But thou, O Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book even to the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased. This is where I believe we're at now. And then in verse 9, go your way, Daniel, for the words are closed up and sealed until the time of the end. The book of Daniel is unique because it's a book that gives you very special time frames. 1,260 days, 1,290 days, 1,335 days. It's very unique. The only other book that does the same thing is the book of Revelation that talks about a tribulation period, 1,260 days plus another 1,260 days, or 42 months and 42 months. Now, the reason I'm sharing that with you is that deals with days. It deals with times. And the Bible talks about times and seasons. I've always said this, and many of you who are partners of our ministry have heard me mention this, that there are actually three distinct ages when you look at the scripture. And the word age in the New Testament is the Greek word aeon, and it means a cycle of time, a time span with certain characteristics in it. And those times are simply ages past, ages present, and ages to come. Ages past is everything from Genesis 1, 2 backwards, creation. Ages present actually deals with, in our time, the new covenant, the dispensation of the grace of God, the church age, this present age Paul talked about. The ages to come is very unique because it deals with not just eternity, as I've often taught, it deals with the millennial kingdom, the 1,000-year reign of Christ. All of that deals with ages to come. However, I want to break this down in a little bit different detail, and follow me carefully. I haven't done this before. Ages past actually is past prophetic history. Ages present is present prophetic signs. Ages to come is the fulfillment of the prophecies. Now, I want to run that again because that's a lot of words said. Ages past is the ages of prophetic history that has already happened. Ages present are the present prophetic signs we see in front of us. But ages to come deals with when the prophecies have been fulfilled and will be fulfilled that are in the far distant future. For example, the 1,000-year reign of Christ is part of that ages to come prophecy that will be fulfilled in the near future. Now, I want you to notice this because this is clearly identified in the book of Revelation, chapter 1 and verse 4. John, to the seven churches which are in Asia, grace and peace be unto you from the Lord Jesus, who which is, which was, and which is to come. We would say it this way: was, is to come. And there's a reason that the Bible says it the way that it does. So there's your three ages. You have the was age, the is age, and the it's coming in the future age. So keep that in mind as we delve into the subject of how God uses those numbers and why he does. Because biblical numbers, as you know, in the scripture have various meanings. Now, many years ago, in order to try to interpret prophecy before a lot of the direct prophecies were being fulfilled, great scholars, especially in the 1800s, would take the book of Daniel and the book of Revelation, and they did what's called an exchange, a prophetic exchange. And in every place where it talked about a day time frame, 1,260 days, 1,290 days, 1,035 days, they exchanged those days for years, and they made it 1,260 years, 1,290 years, 1,335 years. So they had to have a starting point to try to to calculate and add those years to something. So most of them started with the Babylonian captivity or the Babylonian invasion in Israel. And they would start at that date, which is before Christ, and they would go forward 1,260 years. Well, oddly enough, one of the scholars found out that one of those time frames was exactly when the Muslims took over the city of Jerusalem. And then they start finding out that another one of those time frames fit another major time of history. One man even took those time frames and started it with the time that the Muslims took Jerusalem and made those days years from the Bible, used a biblical number, and guess where it came out to? It came out to 1917 on our calendar. And he predicted that the Muslims would lose power over Jerusalem in 1917. Now, the reason I'm telling you that is this. Either they were very lucky when they did that and it just happened to coincidentally fall on those days, or there are certain patterns that develop in prophecy that we need to understand. And I'm going to help, hopefully tonight, give you some of the ideas of how a prophetic calendar is actually kept. Now, I'm going to give you three phrases that I've never used before. And that's saying something after 41 years of preaching. Come on, help me preach, somebody. After 41 years of preaching. Because I'm going to talk about how God reckons time. And reckon sounds like an old word, but reckon is a word meaning calculate. How God calculates time and how men calculate time. Now, I'm going to give you three words. Time reckoning, time indication, time expectation. So because this is new to a lot of you, I'm going to repeat myself from time to time. There is time reckoning, there is time indication, there is time expectation, and everything prophetically in your Bible is a combination of these three times. What are they? First is time reckoning. Time reckoning is done by astronomical and seasonal movements of the sun and the moon and the four seasons. In other words, time reckoning is done by the keeping up with the movement of the sun and the moon as they did in the ancient times, for example, because Israel used to be on a solar lunar calendar. They went by the cycles of the moon each month. Then there is the second phase of this, which is time indication. Now, time reckoning is the movement of the cosmic bodies. You reckon time by that. We know when the earth goes 365.25 days around the sun, it makes a year. You have reckoned or calculated time. But what does it mean for time indication? Time indication is how you keep it on earth. In the early days, it was done by a sundial. Then in sometimes many hundreds of years ago, it was done by an hourglass. Later on, men came up with calendars. You can look at your calendar, and a year from now, it'll tell you a year from now what the calendar is going to be on Thursday of next year. Then it'll take you to another calendar. You can go 10 years, 20 years, 30 years ahead now, and I can calculate when the main event's going to be for the next 30 years should Jesus tarry based on the calendar. So now that we have calendars, we also have clocks. Oh my goodness, I'm 5 minutes late to work. How do you know? Because you've got a clock in front of you that calculates time. So astronomical cosmic time is the time reckoning, but those things that we have on earth, satellite phone that tells me exactly what time it is, this is a time indicator. Now, here's where it gets interesting. There is something called time expectation. Say it with me. Time expectation. Time expectation is when an event is designed by God in history and it is marked to occur at a certain moment in time. Those time expectations are very important because the Bible talks about a set time. Somebody say set time. A set time is interpreted by movement. When there is no movement in prophecy, You are not having any set times occur. But when a movement begins to occur that you point to and say, wait a minute, that's in the Bible, you have encountered a set time which was pre-designed by the Lord in heaven that he revealed to the apostles and the prophets of the Bible. So let me read this little statement. Set time is interpreted by movement, so Bible prophecy is when movement starts occurring. We call it a sign. But a sign is nothing else than a movement of what has been said beginning to be acted out on the earth through a nation, through an empire, through an earthquake, through a pestilence, or whatever the situation may be. When we mark the passage of time, stay with me now. I know it's heavy, but stay with me. When we mark the passage of time, we put a name to it called history. George Washington is history. He's not in the now. Abraham Lincoln, the Civil War, is history, and I sure wish some people would quit revisiting it. It's time to look forward and not backward into our history and see how we can change things and make a better place now. Because you'll never be blessed always looking back. You'll only be blessed. Paul said, forget those things that are behind and reach for the things that are before. Not minimizing what happened, but it's history now. However, when there... I hope this is going to bless me like it bless you like it blessed me. However, when there is an expectation of an event, we call it not history, we call it prophecy. So prophecy, history is marking the passage of time. Prophecy is the expectation of the future of something that has not yet happened. Now, I took you through all of that to get to this statement. We are living between history and prophecy. Let me say it again for all five of you that were excited. We are living right now. People say, what time are we in? Here's the time we are. We're living between history and prophecy. We are living between what has happened to the expectation of what we believe will soon take place. I'm about to preach. I'm just building my foundation right now. The tipping point of prophecy is expectation, and expectation is fulfilled when the event predicted happens in front of your eyes. 1948, on May 14th, May 15th, 1948, David Ben-Gurion stood up and announced that there was a new nation that had existed a long time ago that hadn't been in existence for 1900 years. And he said, it shall be called not Palestine, not Zion, not Judah, not Judea. Those were the four names on a table in Washington to call it. And a rabbi called Harry Truman and said, you got to call it Israel because the prophets of the Bible said it would be called Israel. So they called it Israel. In 1948, the expectation of the coming of the Lord suddenly hit the United States and Britain and England in a time in a level that it had never hit before, because men began to realize that every prophecy about Jesus coming back had Israel a nation when he returned. Every prophecy about the Antichrist had Israel a nation when the Antichrist showed up. Every prophecy about the tribulation was talking about Jerusalem, the Jews, and Israel. And Oral Roberts and Jack Cole and all the other men, why do you think God sent a healing revival in the month of June right after the month of May? In 1948, why do you think Americans showed up to 5, 10, 15, 20,000 people? It was not just so they could be healed. God stirred up the American psyche and the American mind to say, you're not living in history of the destruction of the temple. You're not living in history of the time that the Jews were scattered in 70 AD. You are now living in prophetic time. So get your expectations up that I'm going to return in the very near future. Rod Parsley, my very dear friend, says, expectation is the breeding ground for miracles. Tonight I give you a new phrase. Expectation is the breeding ground for prophetic fulfillment. Now I'm going to prove it to you. Expectation is the breeding ground for prophetic fulfillment. Because if you, Jesus, because In the Bible, in Isaiah chapter 7, 14, the Messiah will be born of a virgin. In the book of Micah chapter 5 and 2, he will be born in Judea in the city of Bethlehem. Those are prophecies. But there came a time when the expectations began to move toward the idea that perhaps we're in the season of the prophecy being fulfilled. Now you say, where's that in the Bible? It's in Luke chapter 2, where an old rabbi by the name of Simeon had a consolation from the Holy Ghost that he was not going to die till he saw the Messiah. And he went up there for years. Every year he looked for the babies that were being circumcised. Every year he would look. Every day when he would go to the temple, he would look in the face of a child. He'd say, can I hold that baby? And he didn't feel a thing. But the expectation was there. He would tell an old woman named Anna, I don't know when it's going to happen, but I have been told that I'm not dying till I see the Messiah. And he kept on going every day with an expectation. Every day looking at another baby where they were paying the 40 days at the temple for that baby's redemption where they were circumcising. But one day a woman came in with a man named Joseph and a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes. And when Rabbi Simeon walked over, he said, do you mind if I hold that one? And when he held that one, he felt something from the top of his head running down the avenues of his soul. He said, oh, Father God in heaven, this is it. I can feel it down in my spirit. This is it. There's something in my knower that tells me this is it. And then he blesses Jesus and he prophesies over that little baby Yeshua. And then he puts his hand up and said, now let thy servant depart in peace, for mine eyes have seen the salvation of Israel. I'm telling you, whether you feel it or not, I feel an expectation on the inside of me. Sometimes I feel like something bad is going to happen in America. And I know that my feeling is not just me. There's times I feel like God is about to send the biggest revival that has ever happened in this country. But I know it's not me. There's times I look at a cloud and I can picture my Jesus coming back with the angels of heaven. I'm telling you, expectation is the breeding ground of Bible prophecy. And if you start expecting it, trust me, you're going to get what you expect. I wish somebody would help me. Now get ready. I knew you'd pick up on it in a minute. Here's the point. At the time of Anna and Simeon in Luke, the expectations were set, the predictions were known, and the season had come for the prophecy to be fulfilled. Now I'm going to tell you this. Ready? It is revelation, not the book of Revelation. It is revelation that breeds expectancy. I have a revelation. It's from the book. I didn't make it up. That Jesus is coming back. With the shout of the voice of the archangel and the trump of God. And the dead in Christ are going to rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the cloud to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore comfort one another with these words. If I go away, I'll come again and receive you unto myself. That where I am, there you may be also. I have read the book. So therefore I have an expectation. But what makes my expectation increase? It's when I gain revelation of the season. Because not everybody can discern what's happening. See, you talk to people about the Lord coming. What are you talking about? You believe that stuff? Yeah. You talk about, man, there was another earthquake. Well, there's always been earthquakes. What's the big deal? An eclipse in the month of Elul. I was the first person that I saw on the internet preaching. Days of Teshuvah, 40 days of Teshuvah. And everybody else picks up on it. Said, God gave me a revelation. Okay, good. I'm glad you got it. All right. So I'm discerning the seasons. But my expectancy can only be bred by the level of revelation I have received on the subject. That's why there's a generation out there who never in their churches hear the rapture taught. There's a generation rising up of millennials, and I just talked to one of the largest church pastors in the United States who's going to have me come and preach prophecy in his church. He got 15 or 20,000 members. And he said, He said, I have come to the conclusion that my generation knows nothing about prophecy. And if the Antichrist showed up right now, he'd deceive most of them. They think technology is great. Put a chip in your hand, that's great. Put a mark that's an invisible tattoo that you can open a door and you can scan and get money. They think it's great, and yet the Bible's warning you against it. Are you listening, somebody? Help me preach this through, Jesus. But see, there cannot be a level of revelation of the prophetic unless you hear the prophetic taught. And I have men that I know of, and I've been told this, that won't have me preach in their church because they say, now, Paris Stone comes and preaches in your church and he gets that prophecy stuff. You know, that prophecy stuff is negative. It is only negative for the people left here when it happens. So if you plan on being left here when Jesus comes back, it's going to be it is a doomsday message. It's a negative message. It's a sad message. It's a hell-breaking loose message. But for those of us that believe that there's an expectation that the Lord is coming back for a bride without spot, wrinkle, or blemish, you don't have to worry about it being doom and gloom. It's hope, 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 hope. The blessed hope of the Lord Jesus Christ is for those who are expecting, for the Bible says, unto they that look for him, he shall appear a second time without sin unto salvation. Ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing? Why were they gazing? They had an expectation. Why were they looking up? They just weren't saying, wow, how cool that is. They thought he could go up and do a U-turn and come right back. They said, but boys, keep your expectation level up from here on up, for this same Jesus, which was taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as you've seen him go. They call me a nut. They call me a heretic. They call me a false prophet because I tell people he's coming back. But there's something inside my spirit called the Holy Ghost that raised Jesus from the dead, that when I talk about his coming, I feel an expectation because I've got a revelation. Somebody better help me in this.
Messages from the main event are now available on CD and DVD. Don't miss these 5 new prophetic messages by Perry Stone and 3 amazing messages by some of America's most anointed ministers. Perry's 5 messages are titled Prophetic Insight into the New Jewish Year 5778, America's Prophetic Cosmic Wars, Demons and Angels, The Chronicles of Counting Prophetic Time, The Sign, the Shaking, and the Seal of the Covenant, and Should a Christian Be a Prepper? In these teachings, Perry shares the stunning prophetic implications concealed in the Jewish New Year 5778. Discover the 6 warfare lessons and the 4 repetitive patterns in history in his message about cosmic wars. Learn how God counts prophetic time with revealed and concealed set times, and how false covenants are initiating the time of the end. Perry shows the rabbinical messianic age sign linked to the Jewish menorah and delves into the controversy of Christian prepping, giving biblical answers dealing with the subject of being prepared for a major crisis. Also included are 3 dynamic messages by guest speakers presenting practical truth for your spiritual growth. Jensen Franklin explains how to be made whole. Ron Carpenter helps you get into the mind of God as he details unlocking the mystery within the mystery. John Kilpatrick delivered a powerful message on releasing the power of the blessing that will change how you speak over your children, family, and church. The 8 CDs are available for your donation of $55 or more. DVDs can be yours for a donation of $95 or more, which includes special pictures and scriptures used by our speakers. To request your set of CDs or DVDs of the main event, visit our website at perrystone.org or call our toll-free number 1-888-21-BREAD. That's 1-888-212-7323. You may also write us at Perry Stone, P.O. Box 3595, Cleveland, Tennessee, 37320, and request offer number 17ME-CDs for $55 or 17ME-DVDs for $95. Shipping and handling are included. We believe you will enjoy the powerful teaching and preaching from the main event and the great spiritual understanding and encouragement it will bring to your life. We look forward to hearing from you soon.
The message was an excerpt from the main event, and the title of it is The Chronicles of Counting Prophetic Time. One of the things that I think surprised people is when I got into the fact of counting time by covenants and how when men on earth alter covenants, that is the breaking point of the judgments of God in the time of the end. I'll give you an example. The oldest covenant in the Bible is the covenant in the garden where God said to Adam and Eve, you know, it's not good for man to be alone. He makes him a helpmeet. Then he tells them to be fruitful and multiply in the earth. So that's the covenant, and we see that covenant emerge in Moses all the way to the time of Christ called the marriage covenant. When men alter a covenant and begin to change what they say a covenant is, you only have a short period of time till major judgment comes to a nation. You can read that in Genesis chapter 19. So I think you need to hear this message, and I hope you'll get either the CDs or the DVDs. The CDs are message only, the DVDs are the message, plus the crowd shots, plus me preaching, plus the pictures. And don't forget, you also get three other speakers, Jensen Franklin, Ron Carpenter, John Kilpatrick, whose messages were just, I don't know how to say it, off the chain. So we hope you'll avail yourself of the opportunity of getting that. Now, when we come into the month of December and January, these are 2 months that I spend a lot of time writing. For example, we're working on 2 books right now, 2 very, very strong books. Very, very informative. One of them has been a year and a half in writing. We are working on the launching of the International School of the Word on the Internet worldwide. We are working on, of course, locally, our OCI ministry, our Tuesday night service at OCI. Everyone's welcome to that. Some people think it's just for young people. It's not. The other day, we had 740 people in the building on a Tuesday night. So everybody locally can come and attend and be a part. It's a great time. And there are some other things that the Lord has put on our heart to do that we're working on. Now, we do not, on the Manna-Fest telecast, tell people everything that we're doing. We do not tell them every area where we're supporting. What I have learned is this: if you ever announce you're doing something, you'll start getting letters from all over the place of people who want you to attach themselves to the ministry or have you support what they do, and you don't even know who they are. And the Bible said you should know those that labor among you, as it relates to support, etc. But we are looking at some things and some doors that God is opening. And so for those who are the partners of our ministry that are on the Partners Private Partners Facebook, that get the 60-second nuggets every morning that we tape for you, we will inform you first of the open doors that God is giving to us because you are the ones who support the work of the ministry. And we thank you for that. You know, the Lord really is coming. I mean, you hear this talked about. My grandfather, John Bava, talked about it. My great-granddad, R.L. Rexroy, talked about it. He was a minister. My father, Fred Stone, he didn't preach a lot on prophecy. He was a great New Testament preacher on the mighty acts and words of Jesus and had a lot of answered prayers in his life, miraculous answers to prayer. But one of the things the Lord has given me, and I believe it's a gift from the Holy Spirit, is to be able to interpret the times. And when major events happen, I know at the ministry center, our phone rings off the hook, the emails are going on, what does this mean, what does this mean? So pray for us for strength, wisdom, and understanding of the knowledge of the Lord, for divine protection from God, that we can continue to do the work that God's called us to do. Be back next week with another excerpt.